Step three in our comb line filter design is the bandpass transformation. We want to go from our prototype shown on the left here. Our prototype just has capacitors and inverters in it, and we want to replace those capacitors by resonators, and in lumped element form, those resonators are parallel L and C elements, and we retain the inverters. First of all, we want to develop a lumped element bandpass filter to use as a reference to see how we're doing later on in the design. So now we're going to replace each of our capacitors by a parallel LC circuit and each of our inductors by a series LC circuit. Now I want you to get an understanding for exactly what we're trying to do here. Let's look at the filter characteristics, the low pass filter characteristics and the high pass filter characteristics. And to see what we're doing in this transformation, it is best to look at the negative and positive frequency responses of the low-pass filter. So here is our low-pass filter response on the left here. We want to translate that positive and negative response up in frequency. So we want to go from the center frequency of the low-pass filter, which is 0 Hz DC, and we want to shift that to the center frequency of our bandpass filter, which will be omega zero. So now we've introduced a new omega zero. We've left the old omega zero behind. We're saying that that is fixed at 1 radian per second, and omega zero refers to the center radian frequency of our bandpass filter. What we want in this translation is we want all of the elements in our low pass filter to have the same impedance at omega zero as it did at DC. So let's look up here at our prototype filter. Here we have a capacitor C11. At DC, that capacitor is an open circuit. When we move to our bandpass filter that we've arrived at through transformation, we want the corresponding element or elements to have the same impedance at the center frequency of the bandpass filter. That is, we want these two elements, L1 and C12 in parallel, to look like an open circuit at the center frequency of the bandpass filter, and that is, they must be a parallel LC circuit. Now that transformation doesn't give us enough information to say what the actual value of L12 is and the actual value of C12 is. It's just telling us that they resonate at omega zero. Similarly, L21 will be a short circuit at DC. Therefore, we want the transformed elements representing L21, and here are the transformed elements here. We want L22 and C21 to look like a short circuit at the bandpass center frequency. Therefore, L and C must form a series resonant circuit. The values for L12, C12, etc. come by considering that at the corner frequency, this corner frequency is going to be 1 radian per second, remember. At the corner frequency, we want the elements to have an impedance which is exactly the same as the impedance at the corner frequency of the bandpass filter. Of course, these bandpass filter corner frequencies will not be just 1 radian per second away from the center frequency of the bandpass filter. They're going to be a little bit further away, so we need to do an additional transformation to be able to account for that. Just to complete things, we want the impedance values at the -1 radian per second frequency to be the same in the transformed filter at the lower corner frequency. So that's what we're trying to do. In fact, all of these transformations we're doing, we're trying to make sure our element has the same value of impedance at the center frequency or perhaps at the corner frequency. Here is the transformation from our lumped element low-pass prototype filter to our lumped element bandpass filter. We need to consider this response. So we have frequency along the bottom here. We have the transmission response on the vertical axis. We have corner frequencies, which are defined by omega 1 and omega 2. And these corner frequencies will not be down 3 dB. They'll be down by the ripple level. And our center frequency is omega zero. So here is the formula that does that translation. I won't go into how that formula was arrived at. That was covered when you considered bandpass filters. Our filter has a center frequency of 1000 megahertz. It has a 10% bandwidth, giving us alpha of 10. So we calculate C12 using that formula, L12 using that formula, and that gives us a bandpass filter which has the response that we want. And just remember that the low pass corner frequency here is 1 radian per second. Some filter tables will give you filter parameters that are normalized to 1 hertz. In that case, you couldn't use these transformation formulas. You'd have to tweak them just a little bit. So here is the response of our lumped element bandpass filter. The S21 response is almost flat in the middle of the band. Now, this is a lossless filter, so the ripples are there. It's just almost impossible to see them at this scale. Remember, our ripple level was 0.04 dB. That corresponds to an epsilon of 0.1. So 0.04 dB is very hard to see on this scale, and with a little bit of loss, that would be perfectly flat, or almost perfectly flat. So the purple curve is S21. The red curve here is S11. S11 will be perfectly matched at the poles of the filter, the poles of the transmission response, and then a little bit less matched as the transmission drops below 1 when we're going through our ripple variation. This points out one interesting piece of information here. There are transmission poles in this response. It is just so hard to see them. But the poles can be seen in the S11 response. In fact, our filter poles are actually zeros in the S11 or reflection response. And there are three of them, one here, one there, and one there. So very often filter design focuses more on designing for a particular reflection than designing for a particular transmission, simply because we can see some of the responses we're looking for more clearly in the reflected response. One comment that is worth making about this graph is that it looks as though it's not symmetrical. That's because the frequency axis is linear. If we plotted the frequency axis on a logarithmic scale, this response would look completely symmetrical. Returning now to the prototype filter that we're evolving. This is the prototype filter with inverters. We follow the same procedure. These capacitors end up becoming parallel LC elements. We calculate them using the same formula that we did before. The inverters stay in place because those inverters look exactly the same at all frequencies. They don't need to go through any bandpass transformation. And again, the low pass corner frequency is 1 radian per second. So let's look at our transform bandpass filter again and see how we are getting closer and closer to the final form that we want. We have three resonators here. These are parallel LC resonators, and each of them can be modeled by a stub. So they will be accurate at the center frequency of the bandpass filter, which is the resonant frequency of the stubs. So now we have three shorted stubs that can be replacing those parallel LC elements. And if we look at our comb line filter now, if we look at our third order comb line filter now, approximately each of these stubs corresponds to one transmission line. Now, what is missing here is the fact that we have inverters, and those inverters are not precisely implemented by the coupling of those microstrip lines. Now, recall that the desired basic circuit structure we want is as shown here. We want a pi arrangement of shorted stubs. We're getting closer and closer to that, but there's a little missing piece here. Generally, the coupling across here will look like an inverter, but it's not precisely an inverter. And so we need to continue our synthesis to see exactly how we're going to accommodate that. So in summary, at the end of this step, this is our next stage prototype. It's our first bandpass filter prototype. It's still a prototype because we haven't realized it yet.